This is the FM Gold channel of All India Radio. In the program News Analysis, now we bring you a discussion on emerging scenario of the poll results in five states. The participants are Professor Himanshu Roy, political analyst, and Vijay Kranti, journalist.
Today, finally, we have the results for five states: Mizoram, Telangana, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and Rajasthan. The whole nation was waiting for these results, holding the breath. Finally, we have the results, and there are changes which many people didn't expect. For example, in Mizoram, Congress has lost, but at the same time, Congress has snatched three states from BJP: Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and Rajasthan. What these results speak for the coming shape of politics of India, especially the coming Lok Sabha elections in 2019. Professor Roy, we have been watching since last Lok Sabha elections in 2014 that Congress has been losing continuously elections, and this is suddenly a very relief shower for Congress. It's winning three very major states. What does it speak for Congress and for Indian politics?
You are right that it will give boost to the confidence of the Congress leadership and the party as a whole. They have been trying in Karnataka of late in recent months, in Gujarat, and they failed in both the states. In the current election results of today, we find that their success in the three major states of North India, particularly the two, Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan, will definitely give a boost to the Congress party. But one thing I must clarify here, that this politics even of Mahagathbandhan or alliance that the opposition parties are forging, either in assembly election or they may be forging for the Lok Sabha election in 2019, for which already the political process is on, may not succeed, because we have seen in Telangana that the Mahagathbandhan that was formed between the TDP and the Congress, that failed miserably. And look on the other side, the alliance that was formed in Mizoram, that has partly gained, because first time we find BJP opening its slot in Mizoram by winning one seat there.
But as far as you just now spoke of Mahagathbandhan and the scope of parties joining hands for the coming elections, so far we were watching that because there was no outstanding leader among these political parties, and egos, of course, is a very big issue among those leaders. Do you think those leaders who have their own egos and they are heading different major parties, are they going to accept Mr. Rahul Gandhi as a common candidate because of his victory in these three states?
Now they may, because Congress still is the largest party among the opposition parties. Another one party which has a pan-Indian presence in almost all the states of India and the two union territories of India, Pondicherry and Delhi. Then Congress is one party which will be acceptable to everyone, because there is no other alternative before the opposition who can be accepted as a prime ministerial candidate or as a leader for the next Lok Sabha election.
Let us hope, but as far as the indications that came from individual leaders like Mamata Banerjee and the TDP leader and the Samajwadi Party group and Mayawati, let us see what happens to that. One issue which is quite striking when this election campaign was going on, it appears to be a little unfortunate that the overall standard of discourse, sometimes we saw allegations which leaders made against each other, they were avoidable. So does it show that there is some deterioration in the democratic values, or it's just a reflection of temporary desperation?
No, overall there is a deterioration of the Indian politics in terms of these personal allegations that we are witness for the last 30-40 years. There is no doubt about it. But in spite of it, we find that the electorate in India has matured enough in the last 30-40 years that they cannot be befooled by the leaders of the different political parties. And the voters have voted according to their requirements in different elections.
I think that's the silver lining. And one more thing which I would like to point out. We saw that in the last 15 years, BJP governments, especially in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, these have been welfare governments. Rather, in Chhattisgarh, the chief minister was more popular among very poor people as Chawal Baba, that he was giving them almost free rice and food. But people have not voted for him. Does it show that proverbial 15-year itch, was it that they were sick of seeing the same face, or people have matured beyond taking freebies and giving both.
Apart from that, the two regions that you are pointing out, the third may be that now the standard of the people have gone so much because of the new demographic change and the young population. After every 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 5 years, they want a constant change, a constant upgradation of the standard of life. Let's keep it in mind that 60% of the population of India, as per the 2011 census, is young, in between 18 to 35 age group, and they are highly aspiring. It's very difficult for any state government or a federal central government to match their aspirations with rapidly changing this age group population. So it's another point or argument that in the 15 years, what they performed in terms of developing the infrastructure, that they have done tremendously, or different kind of welfare measures that you are referring to, the administrative measures that have been taken by Chhattisgarh government or Madhya Pradesh government in particular, so that may not be now satisfying all the sections of the society.
But does it speak of change in expectations of ordinary voter, the ordinary citizen, that they expect a much larger kind of development?
Yes. Otherwise, I fail to understand why, after doing so much of administrative works in terms of developmental work done by these two estates in particular, that we all have been witness to, from personal to in public domain, these two governments after 15 years have failed. The simple reason may be because the new generation wants a constant, rapid performance from the government, which is being felt very harshly by the ruling party to act according to the new requirements.
You spoke of the new generation and their changing expectations. It also brings us to another issue that we are watching for the last few years. There have been too many elections. Every few months, we are watching elections for sometimes two states, sometimes five states, and the process is going on and on. And the result is that many times, because of these elections, there are bindings on the central government, on the state governments, and they cannot go ahead with new policy decisions. Don't you think the question of having simultaneous elections of states and the Lok Sabha, it's gaining ground, or it's becoming more reasonable?
The argument that you are positing here is absolutely very rational, that since 71 onwards, you will find that the constant elections almost every year, 2 years, first in the assembly and the Lok Sabha, etc. And this has led to sort of the different governments not applying their policies because of the model code of conduct. And therefore, the speed of development that has slowed down. Yes. There is no doubt about it. But the problem is, unless all the political parties come together and there is a consensus in the parliament to enact a law for one time simultaneously elections, both in the assembly and the Lok Sabha, it cannot be.
But that might happen on the day when their own aspirations and hope for something more is overtaken by this, what you call, burnout among leaders and party networks. It's almost showing.
Even if you look at the social media, the way it's being reacted by the young population, you will find that the younger population is fed up with this everyday election and they want a constant development rather than these electoral campaigns of the different political parties in different states of India. So it will be better that there is a simultaneous election, as you are suggesting.
During the day, as the election results were pouring in, and it was getting almost clear that Congress is going to form government in Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh and Rajasthan, we have been getting news from Madhya Pradesh, from Rajasthan, about the clash of personalities within Congress. You might have seen that instead of the slogans, the dancing crowds, rather than shouting Rahul Gandhi Jindabad, they were shouting Kamal Nath Jindabad, and on the other camp, Sindhia Jindabad. Same thing in Rajasthan. Now, what does it show?
See, even before election results, when the seats were and the candidates were finalized and the chief ministerial candidates were to be declared, there was a conflict of interest that who should be declared the chief ministerial candidate. and the ruling party or the opposition parties kept on pestering them, the Congress party, please declare your chief ministerial candidate. And the central leadership of the Congress party, they avoided declaring the chief ministerial candidate.
But is it going to prove an asset or a problem for Congress?
Now, after the election result, the two conflicting sides, out of which only one will be the chief minister, so definitely the other won't be able to be cooperating because their aspirations, maybe one becomes the deputy chief minister. But in the case of their groups or the factions, all cannot be compensated or all cannot be accommodated. So someone will be a loser. That loser in long term, another 4, 5, 6 months, may prove detrimental for the Congress.
In the Lok Sabha election, I think in Mizoram, the way MNF has performed is quite remarkable. And similarly in Telangana, K. Chandrasekhar Rao, he had courage of dissolving assembly much before the due date and then coming back winner. So in these two states, do you see any trend in smaller states?
I was in Aizawl in first week of October, and the feedback that I got from the academia and the students community, that was reflecting the trend that NF is going to win. Then I was in Hyderabad, Usmania University, which is the nerve center when the movement was going on for the formation of Telangana, and in Warangal, Kakatiya University. These were the centers for the formation of new Telangana state. So the local students, the public intellectuals, the academia and the civil society, they were all very happy with the performance of the ruling party and the government. In fact, a critique of the ruling party and the government there was opposed by the local Telanganites.
Very remarkable development, which I'm sure everybody would have appreciated. Whatever be the level of discourse among political leadership, but the level of maturity at the level of the ordinary voter was remarkable. Not one place there was violence and there was no disruption, and people voted in quite a big number. Don't you think this is a silver line for Indian democracy, that our process is maturing and the voter is also maturing?
Absolutely, I agree with you that this is the strongest part of the Indian democracy, that the number of participants have been increasing. That's the most remarkable thing. And look at their maturity, irrespective of the political leadership's personal allegations and charges. They have been voting according to their own requirements, not being influenced by the televisions and the social medias and this and that. This reflects the maturity of the Indian electorate.
At the same time, would you agree with me if I say that there is one more unsung hero of this whole process, Election Commission? Don't you think they have done a remarkable work? I think world's largest exercise of largest number of people, and everything going in right place, almost like
clockwork. No one can doubt the role played by the Election Commission, because such a huge territory like Rajasthan, such a huge territory like Madhya Pradesh, and such a difficult terrain like Mizoram, and handling these five different states simultaneously at one go so smoothly with minor aberrations here
and there. So, Professor Roy, I think we agree on the few basic issues. Whatever be the results and whatever is going to happen, everybody is going to watch it very soon. But a few things which need to be underlined. One is the Indian voter is maturing. Second is the Indian democracy has come to stay as a very healthy trend. And for all this, a big part of credit goes to Election Commission, who have performed so well. Thank you very much.
You were listening to a discussion on emerging scenario after poll results in five states. The participants were Professor Himanshu Roy, political analyst, and Vijay Kranti, journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. This program is also available on our website news.air.nic.in. You may email opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.